James Cameron's Aliens concluded with four characters escaping the xenomorph outbreak on the LV-426 colony. Ripley, the lone survivor of the Nostromo from the original film, Corporal Hicks, a colonial marine left badly burned by an alien's acid blood, Bishop, a synthetic who was torn in half by the alien queen, and Newt, a resident of the colony with whom Ripley shared an important bond of survival and surrogate motherhood. With more characters surviving this time around, an opportunity was left open to keep the series continuing by following different characters should Ripley not return for a third film, as Sigourney Weaver was famously reluctant to agree to a sequel in the first place, and at least at the time of Aliens being released, had no further plans to star in further entries. William Gibson's unproduced script for Alien 3 shifted the focus to the characters of Hicks and Bishop as the leads, finding themselves on the Anchor Point space station and working to put a stop to a new alien outbreak. As the story opens, Ripley's cryopod is damaged and she's left in a coma, not present or aware of any of the action taking place. While Newt is also not involved in any of the main conflict with the new outbreak, the character is actually present for a significant portion of the first act, as explored just a little bit further. After the events of Aliens, the Sulaco drifts into an area of space claimed by the Union of Progressive Peoples due to a navigational error. UPP officers investigate the ship and find, to their horror, that a xenomorph egg had materialized inside the android Bishop's cryotube. A facehugger attacks, and in a panic, the UPP officers retreat with Bishop's torso, which contains data on the Hadley's Hope incursion and detailed information on the xenomorph specimen. Ripley, Hicks, and Newt are left behind, eventually routed to Anchor Point Station, owned and operated by Weyland-Yutani. The three humans are retrieved from the hypersleep bay in the Sulaco, now docked at the station. Upon awakening from hypersleep, Newt is distraught, finding herself confused and among strangers, with Ripley and Hicks nowhere in sight. In true Newt fashion, she bites the hand of one of the orderlies, who eventually escorts her to the medlab quarantine where Hicks is being held. Newt struggles and screams and demands to see Ripley, while Hicks, immediately becoming protective upon seeing her, echoes her sentiments. One of Anchor Point's resident scientists, Spence, sees Newt in her vulnerable state, on the floor, pressed against the wall, hugging her knees, and attempts to comfort her. She brings Newt and Hicks to see Ripley, who is comatose. Spence tries explaining to Newt that she's sleeping, and sometimes people just need to sleep to get over things. Newt asks if Ripley's dreaming, to which Spence replies that she doesn't know. Not taking her attention off of Ripley, Newt says that it's better not to. A sad change to her disposition from the end of Aliens, where both Ripley and Newt looked forward to sleeping all the way home and finally being able to dream. Wells, a representative from Weyland-Yutani's bioweapons division, boards the station and shows an interest in Newt, her primary concern being whether or not this little girl will keep silent about her experiences on LV-426. She brings Newt to the station's Echo Module, described in the script as an experimental pocket Eden. A half-acre of artfully ragged concrete Disneyland into lush rainforest, with sun-dappled miniature meadows and patches of African cactus. There, Newt and Wells have a one-on-one talk. The conversation carries an implication that Newt's silence would be rewarded with compensation from the company, as she's enchanted by one of the Echo Module's animals, a lemur, and mentions she'd like to visit Africa. Wells says that shouldn't be a problem, provided she remembers the things they've discussed about not telling. Spence soon joins Wells, and the two briefly discuss Newt's mental state after her experiences. While they admit they carry no psychiatric expertise, both seem to agree that the little girl doesn't seem to be carrying any kind of trauma. Wells advises that upon arriving at Gateway Station, Newt will undergo therapy, after which arrangements have been made for her to live on Earth, in Oregon, with her grandparents, the only relatives the company could track down. Wells leaves, and Spence spends some time alone with Newt. Newt seems, in a subtle, innocent enough way, suspicious of Wells. She asks Spence if she likes her, and she says that she does, but Newt doesn't seem to be convinced. Before leaving, Newt sees Hicks to say goodbye and expresses concern that Ripley won't be able to find her once she wakes up. Hicks assures her and helps her write down a map and the location in New Portland where she'll be staying. She's taken Ripley one last time and leaves the map close by, hoping she'll come to see her once she's awake. The Sulaco has been swept for biohazards, necessary repairs have been made, and the autopilot has been set for Gateway Station as Newt is escorted to her cryotube. Hicks sees her off, she shares a final affirmative with him and leaves on her journey. As the Sulaco leaves Anchor Point Station, this marks the ending of Newt's involvement in this story. This is where things are left with the Newt character. She doesn't take part in any of the main action of the story, never put in harm's way, never even aware there was any looming harm at the time, and is easily transitioned out of the story. While she isn't exactly important to the plot, there's at least some purpose served in how she views some of the key players that help in their development as we, the audience, also begin to develop an opinion. Through Newt, we see the kindness and compassion of the Spence character, who would later go on to play an integral role in fighting off the alien outbreak along with Hicks and Bishop. We also see Wells in her cold, calculating ways, who is, of course, a ruthless company representative, and would also become host to the insidious Xenomorph hybrid, which later stalks the station. While given a small role with not too much to do in the overall scheme of things, most fans of the Newt character would agree it's a more respectful way of having the character exit than what happens in the final film version of Alien 3 with having her character killed off. By keeping the character alive and setting her aside, there still would have been an opportunity to revisit the character later, in adulthood. The torch could be passed to her with the departure of Ripley, which at least at some point was the plan, and was actually what we saw played out in the original Aliens comics. While the new adaptations of William Gibson's Alien 3 aren't meant to serve as any kind of retcon or course correction to the film version that was ultimately produced of Alien 3, and work more as sort of a novelty and a what-if scenario, it certainly gives us a fascinating look into what could have been done with this character. If you've read the script or comic or listened to the audio drama, how do you feel specifically about the handling of the Newt character? Was the character done justice? Do you think she should have had a bigger role and maybe should have been involved more along with Hicks and Bishop? Do you think she wasn't a necessary addition and could have been worked out entirely with a few lines of exposition? And since this unproduced version of Alien 3 has gained a new life with these adaptations and has gotten new attention from fans who may not have been aware of it over the years, do you prefer it to the film version of Alien 3 that we actually got? I'd love to hear your thoughts. Please comment below and let me know what you think. As always, I'd like to thank you very much for watching today. I really appreciate it. And if you enjoyed this video, please make sure to give it a like, and you can also subscribe for all the latest videos from the channel. A very, very special thanks goes out to Weyland-Yutani executives, Emmerich, Mark Fox, and in the Ellen Ripley tier of excellence, Lady Anne. My thanks also goes out to the Hive Queens, Ronnie Jensen, Alisane, and Jackson Roche, all part of the Patreon Hive. If you'd like to join the Hive and support the channel, check out my Patreon page for exclusive posts and contests. In the meantime, you can catch up with Alien Theory over social media. Follow at @alien_theory on Twitter and at @AlienTheoryYT on Facebook and Instagram for more. And until next time, this is Alien Theory, signing off.